King.
How's everyone? All right, let us officially call the meeting to order at 7:07. I will let the ministry reflect that all the board members are present, and as well as a number of members of staff and a number of members of the audience that we're going to hear from here shortly. We have the minutes of March 23rd before us, and would entertain a motion of approval for those minutes.
I will second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing no discussion, the minutes will stand approved as written. Thank you, Lisa. Appreciate that. The next item is our monthly reports. All the monthly reports for March are in, with the exception of personnel. And Tracy assured me that I would have those before she left here tonight. So we'll be good there. All right, we have no public hearings this evening. We have a couple of guests. The first one is Christy, a.k.a. Jeff Rennish, and Mr. Costell.
Like
I'd ask that you tee it up. This is Jeremiah's Tavern, discussion around the addition of an outdoor bar extension.
Thank you, Tony. Jeff is here this evening. He and Christy had submitted some materials to you a while back, requesting that they be allowed to expand their existing outdoor bar area, which I think is right now about 21.7 feet, something like that in terms of length. They would like to add an additional 6 feet on, and Jeff, I'll let you talk a little bit about the seating and the rationale for it.
Yes, right now it says 20 on the sheet. I apologize for that, that's incorrect. It's actually 14. And we believe by extending it out 6 feet, we're going to get another 8 seats and really gain more surface area for our bar, which we need for washing of dishes and storing of supplies and beer and wine and mixers and stuff of that sort. So it would really just look exactly like what you see here. It would just be a little bit bigger. So what we propose is to take the roof off, build a bigger one, same style, and just move out 6 feet.
And you had televisions hanging from there, two screens?
We do, we have two on each side, so that stays the same.
Same.
So it'll be in the exact same location it is now, just
yes.
Extended out.
Yeah. Do you have to relocate the fire pit?
Nope.
At all?
No.
Okay. And then the imagery that Jim did send us a while back included at least part of a fixture that I had not recognized before, which was like a green slanted roof off to the north side.
When but you were going to put the awning?
No, this was
in relationship to this?
Yes, I mean it was on the north side, so it looked like in the picture it would have been there.
Oh, I'm not aware of that one at all.
So this gets back to, I think, what Rob is referring to as the shed roof, if you will, that was being proposed. Last year.
Right.
That was
instead of him calling the awning.
I thought the awning was hanging off the building itself.
Yeah, mm-hmm. No, you're right, Rob. The intent was to have an awning hanging off the building.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I don't remember sending you anything that would have indicated that there'd be anything other than the structure itself.
Yeah. No. I'm not saying that it was a request. I'm saying that the picture had something like that in it. So I was curious to know if we're going to be approached again anytime soon for something different.
Are you talking about off the side of the building?
No.
I think wasn't it the overhang, you mean, that was initially
No, that's the thing we're all talking about.
No.
No. Is there anything else that you're thinking
you
about?
Did get...
We are looking into an awning, yes. But there's no awning that is there now.
No, it's not there now. It was proposed, if we go back last year.
Yeah, we had talked about doing a permanent structure.
Overhang. That is correct.
And then we had talked, then it went back to you guys, and you said you needed a sprinkler, and I said, no, that
right,
I'm not going
right,
to do
that's
that.
That's what I recall,
right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it was off the table at that point.
Okay.
Let me give this to Cass.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rob. Yeah, but I mean, you know what this was? This was a rendering that was done at the time that they had actually come in for site plan approval. It was an original rendering showing just where the outdoor area was going to be. But you're right, that is not
okay.
That's see, not what you approved.
Okay,
that's right.
My yep, question right. Then was, I just was curious to know if we'd be approached anytime soon for additional outdoor fixtures.
For an awning, you very
but,
well.
But the awning was attached to the building. This goes back, apparently, what Jim says, to the original.
I don't know what you're talking about. Can I see
it? Yeah. Let me bring it up.
I think it was one of the original architectural
renderings. I think it's not relevant anymore.
Yeah, I agree.
It's
just
relevant.
Yeah,
no, post-construction.
We're not
going to
do that.
Post-construction.
Not unless you guys want to pay for it.
What's wrong with that, right?
Yeah.
The original size of the bar wasn't the original either. So here we are again after a few different applications to expand the outdoor patio.
Okay, but you were asking about, you do still want to do an awning?
I'm getting pricing on awning right
okay,
now.
Okay, even yeah. though you...
But it's not a permanent...
You walked away before.
Well, that was because we were going to put a permanent structure in there. And try to match it to the building with the wood and all that and It was too costly because right. of the sprinklers.
Sure.
Right, so once you get the price, you're going to come back to us with something else. So there is more coming.
That's
the
question. Which I'm fine with the expansion of the bar. Like I said, the imagery that we got 2 weeks ago prior to the last work session had other features that I was just curious to know if they were going to come back. So, all right.
I support this. I think it's a nominal request. It's a good sign that business is doing good. And if Mr. Radish comes back with an awning, then there's a reason why he's coming back with an awning. I would assume that he, has good intentions to do that. Mm-hmm. And I'm okay with this.
Yeah.
I'm
good. Okay.
And again, 14 additional seats. Is that what I?
No, she had put on 20. We only have 14 now.
Yes.
And with the two, we're looking at 22 total.
Got it.
Mm-hmm. Eight additional.
All right. Any other questions, board?
Nope.
Any other comments, feedback, Jeff, from our end?
A good job maintaining your refuse process, and you haven't had any kind
of. I'm glad that's working out because they're.
That's working out.
Yeah.
Well, are you all on the same refuse hauler now?
I believe so.
Yeah, that's good.
They don't pick up our trash all the time, but that's another issue.
Those are good news.
All right. Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank
appreciate
you very much.
It, Jeff.
Thanks,
thank
Jeff.
You. Yep. All right, our next item, next guest is Dr. Falone, and this is an update on the site plan, 2146 Fairport 9 Mile Point Road. Dr. Falone, long time no see.
Back again.
I do have the map up behind Linda and Paula, and that's okay, you said where we are. And I have marked out the area. There's two questions involved in this discussion this evening. Number one is whether or not you're comfortable or not comfortable with what he's proposing.
Give you a little spotlight,
please. I do, and I don't want to blind you, but
there you go.
Right here is an issue, and that is where the existing limited or business non-retail zone is, mm-hmm. and above that is where the general business zone is, and you've been wrestling with the BNR zone allowing incentive zoning to occur in this BNR, this portion of the BNR zone, the back portion stays BNR as a transition zone to the residents. Dr. Flone is now proposing to come in with a building that crosses over into the general business zone. Staff has been talking to Tony about how to deal with that, whether or not we should have a meeting with the planning board, or we should just deal with it as an incentive zoning program. Even though there really is no incentive for that portion of the property, there still is one, though, for this area here. Mm-hmm. So it's really going to come down to you. We do need to talk to Dick Horowitz a little bit about that, and I think that you were going to try and talk to Pete as well about it. But
I haven't yet, but I was going to reach out to him and see if there's any issues with the town board handling it versus doing a joint meeting. I'll brief the planning board on it tomorrow night as a work session, about it. But I think as we had discussed and discussed with Tony, I mean, if legally it's okay, it seems to make the most sense since this board has handled the other portions of it, has kind of set the trend of it, that it kind of continued down that path. And
so we would hear it and certainly would welcome any input from the planning board as, certainly an interested, to a certain degree, involved party.
Mm-hmm.
So we also have with us tonight John Shields, who's the author of the site plan, and he's been working with Dr. Flone and the staff now for a couple of years. And I know that the board, a couple of you in particular, have been concerned about making sure, I don't know, I'm not getting any juice here, but making sure that the back portion of the property, there's still some fairly mature trees out there that we wanted to preserve where we can. And I have talked to Dr. Flone about that. Right now, there's no intent to do anything. And, you know, I think a lot of it is going to be predicated on what may happen here on the remainder of the trial property, because I think you're looking to develop that possibly at some point in the future, which would then allow for this to mainly become a small parking area where you could kind of berm off the backside of it, leave a lot of the trees intact, and not even go as far as what we had to do for the office building down here.
The trial property's general business.
It is, yes. Everything north of this line here is all general business. So you probably would not see any more development applications if it goes into the trial property after this one. It'll all go back to the planning board.
So, Doctor, is your intent still to look at or pursue the car wash and bring that into your portfolio?
Yes.
And then, if memory serves me correct, there looks like, and John, maybe this is a question for you, looks like there may have been some tweaks or changes there to some exit points, maybe some proposed modifications to some exit points.
For the car wash property, the existing car wash property?
Yeah, that's not changing.
Well, that's an access point that comes from the south end.
Yeah, that's existing.
Right.
It would remain.
We did talk the other day about the possibility, if additional development occurred, particularly in this area, because I think you are thinking about coming back to the planning board for something north of the car wash, we would then look at this as an opportunity to eliminate that curb cut and then utilize the new curb cut, which will be moved a little bit further to the north, and utilize that as the main entrance in and out of the site. I think, in reality, what he's trying to do is he's trying to work with the state DOT to get some modifications up here, and that would be an option for them to talk about in terms of eliminating that as part of the process.
So what's the thoughts on the property that the house was on that got torn down the one you bought?
And this is it right here. Yeah, this is the former Reese property
right
here. And then what he wants to do is he wants to take the property line, which is right about in here somewhere, and he wants to move that property line up to here now, which will incorporate all that into one parcel.
Is that what we're talking about tonight, is just moving property lines, not out of business?
Well, the other part of it is he is talking about, after his discussions with you about the type of building and the type of uses that you were interested in, you did indicate to him that you didn't want anything other than retail and possibly restaurant. Mm-hmm. That's what he's proposing now for this site, from what I understand. And and your comment to me was that the intent is to build a building similar in nature to what you have just completed.
Correct.
In terms of style and design. Mm-hmm. I want to get your comfort level as to whether you think this is an appropriate layout for this site.
Well, it continues on, right?
It, just it continues
like you have
on,
hose,
right.
And you have this, and then you have the car wash.
Right. And again, again, the intent is, I know on your part and certainly staff's part and probably Dr. Flone at this point in time, is to try and maintain as much mature vegetation back here for the time being as possible. And then I think, as I say, what's dependent upon the trawl property may occur on the remainder of this property, which could be a parking lot, if nothing else.
So this building could be a lot larger than the other buildings because you're going deep?
It's 1,000 square foot larger.
So the proposed building now is how many square feet?
The existing where the Moses is 6,000, this is 7,200,
I think is what's on there.
We do have more than one thing in there?
Potential two to three. Mm-hmm. Right now we have a letter of intent from Sleepy's, which is a mattress store, mm-hmm. for 4,000 square feet. And then another retailer similar to a Lens Crafter. Mm-hmm. They need about 1,600. If they go forward, then we'd have about 14 to 1,600 left, so okay. It would be three tenants.
Right. And parking, well, with those kind of activities, you wouldn't have a...
That's right, you would have a lot of need for parking.
Yeah. Yeah.
But by the same token, again, as if the trial property develops at some point in time and he adds additional parking on, that will give them more than enough than what they need. The other thing that I know you're interested in, because we've been talking about that for a long time, this is part of the process where the roadway will be completed. It'll be tied into the existing road, so it'll all be done at one time.
There's no more trail property. This would hook up.
Well, yes, because right now there's a tie-in right about here, uh-huh. now, so he would just tie that all in and get it over with. Because you've got to use that to get, you know, to get out to the trial property, which eventually will probably be yours, so. And that's part of the incentive process for what you're looking at now.
Sounds good. Andy, much better than last time we met.
Okay.
Other questions, other comments, board?
I'm in full encouragement of always eliminated curb cuts, so just get that out there. And then as you move forward with the car wash property, hopefully working with DOT to do what needs to be done there on the north side to close up the entry only there on the south side. That's all, but that's not really relevant to this particular parcel, so I have no problem moving forward.
So the action items that we have that we're going to wait for is input from the two attorneys as it relates to one hearing, two hearings, or combined hearing. And so we'll have that component, and that will address the separation between the business non-retail and the general business. And then the uses that you heard by way of Sleepeasy and something similar to a lens care type of service in that location fits within what the board was more looking for based on our conversation last meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the next step would be, you know, looking to make a formal application for public hearing.
Right.
For this, and so the question for the board would be, are we good to move forward with that?
I am.
Yeah.
We'll get the information for you from the attorneys. The other thing, too, is obviously you're going to have your architect prepare some renderings for the building four sides for the board as part of the application.
Okay.
You know that.
Okay.
You're working on stormwater still for us?
Absolutely.
All right.
You got it.
Other questions from the board or staff?
No, just one comment as it relates to the complex. I did send you some information about signage, which we're not discussing this evening. Mm-hmm. That's up to you at a later date.
Right.
Other signs will be coming in for the other two sites, and you'll get a chance to review those as well. So.
Okay, so when will we expect to see those?
Do you want them for the meeting?
No, he's referring to the Moe's building. Oh. You gave us Moe's, and we're going to be...
We're just waiting on Harris's sign company.
Okay.
I'd rather come in all at once.
All at once.
And
I think that would be the, you know, the preferred way to go, certainly.
Absolutely.
To take a look as to how it all ties together.
Right.
Particularly the AT&T background issue. We want to get that resolved.
Right.
Yeah.
Logo issue, colors?
The color issue, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. When do you first see these businesses opening?
June 1st.
I've had so many people ask me when Moe's is going to open.
I know.
You asked, Linda, because I was just about to.
Okay, so we'll be looking to set a public hearing, and whenever that meets by way of advertising and plans ready, applications complete, things like that. Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Any other input from the applicant prior to breaking tonight?
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen.
Tony, we had a meeting this afternoon with Rudy Neufeld, and he requests that we hold off on the sidewalk issue. He's got some more work for us to do before you make a kind of decision.
Okay.
Look at,
so we'll let the minutes reflect action item number one under law and finance request for sidewalk waiver at Barclay Park subdivision. We'll hold that until the April 27th meeting. All right, we'll move on to action items, public works. Mr. Boyce has joined us to talk a little bit about some top soil sales at Fox Hill Section 6 Fedyk.
I shared this with the board Friday. His email out. There's about 5,000 cubic yards you're looking to process on site. You get a 3 to 4 month period to do those sales. Obviously, depends on how fast it sells and how fast it goes in and out. We want to bring Mr. Boyce in and have a discussion with the board and see if there's any issues or concerns with doing topsoil sales out of that property. And this is the last portion of Fox Hill that was complete, and then the connection link between National Rise and Fox Hill. So this is the last piece in that neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So certainly a couple of questions that I think that we hear whenever we get into topsoil sales is as it relates to, you know, the time of the screenings, you know, dust, you know, those types of things. Certainly, Bill, that you've given us, you know, approximately 3 to 4 months, depending upon how sales go, and about a 5,000 total yards of excess material there. Any thoughts, ideas by way of time of actually, you know, sifting and running your equipment, and then number of days per week, you know, timelines, things like that?
Well, usually we work Monday through Friday, 7 o'clock to 5:30, but we don't load trucks until 7:30 in the morning, and I don't load them after 4:30 at night. That way, when people are home, the trucks aren't in the subdivisions. Mm-hmm. But my operator will be there sifting dirt till like 5:30 to try to stay out of the trucks.
Not on the weekend.
We usually work on Saturdays from 8 till noon. Oh. You know, we try to be out there by 12 o'clock. You know, people have the rest of the weekend. You know, we try to work Saturdays just because, you know, like in this situation, it's a hard area to get in and out of. Mm-hmm. You know, we just want to get in and out as fast as we can.
Yeah.
And a lot of our little customers that take 1 yard on, they only have Saturdays. Mm-hmm. You know, because a lot of them work during the week and they do this on the side on Saturdays. Pedal and topsoil.
How close is it to the closest neighbor? I mean,
the closest neighbor is actually Mrs. Fedyk, and we're going to set up in her lot next to her, so I don't think we'll have any problem with her. So.
Well, it just seems like the biggest concern is when, you know, it's blowing, mm-hmm. the dirt, you know.
There is a neighbor to the east, and what we already talked about, me and my operators, once we get screening, we start gaining the pile of extra rocks. We're going to kind of build a berm between him and those properties, trying to control that the best we can. Usually we build a crushed stone driveway right off the gutter, mm-hmm. all the way in, and the trucks generally can stay. We build like a hammerhead, so the trucks can come in, stay on the stone, and try to not run through the dust anymore than we have to. And we try to eliminate as much as we can on it.
Mark, is there any communication with neighbors required, any notice or anything, as far as, you know, what he's just talking about in terms of just simply reaching out to that person just to let them know what?
I mean, we can. I mean, there's nothing officially in our policy that says that it's required as part of it, the topsoil sales permit, but, you know, we can reach out to the neighbors, just at least let them know what's going on. It typically falls under our normal hours of operation for construction. And
I was
thinking
about one neighbor, maybe. I don't know if you want to have some sort of outreach to that person, just so that
I'd be glad to reach out to them and at least to share what's going on. If they have issues, concerns, mm-hmm. we can work with them to handle that.
So if we issue this permit and we start running into problems, we have the option of revoking the permit at any time. Would that be correct?
You could revoke it, or you could also sit down with Mr.
Right.
Boyce.
And right. Yeah, obviously we can issue a stop work order on the thing at the time if we're running into issues. Obviously a conversation to him first before we issue a stop work order. Yeah. We've worked with Mr. Boyce in the past at several locations. To date, I can't recall having issues with their stuff. Most recently, you were in Crown Point doing work there and had no issues, concerns, you know, from the neighbors at that location. But you know, as the board has said, we had stuff in the past. Obviously, you know, my first phone call is to him, you know, let him know we had a concern issue, you know, have him address it. If the issue continues, you know, we can issue a stop work order and bring him back to the board and, you know, address the concern if it continues or it's not been appropriately addressed.
Yeah, the way the pile is actually piled, I gave you that picture of
I mean, it's long and linear, up against the tree line, so it kind of self-buffers itself.
Yeah, like I said, the only problem is this one neighbor, which would be over here. So me and the operator talked that we're going to actually start kind of tunneling south to north. So we leave a wall of dirt between us and as many houses as we can. Mm-hmm. We got one neighbor here, then there's the cul-de-sac, then it's almost halfway down the pile before you have the actual next neighbor to come.
I think it would be helpful for them to know that, because it sounds like you're making, you know, taking measures to protect you know, eliminate nuisance to them, and it sounds good to, you know, reach out to the neighbors in some fashion. Mark, you may have some suggestions as to how he or you can do this. I think you eliminate people wondering what's going on and placing calls, or if they know up front what's going on. And know a time frame. Everybody wants to know how long it's going to, you know, how long it's going to last, so.
I asked for, I think, 4 months, 3 months? 3 to 4.
Yeah.
And 5,000 yards, I mean, we should be out of there in 2 months, more or less, but I can't say it's going to happen. That's why I asked for the permit longer than.
When do you want to start?
Emissions permit, you know, Mother Nature controls us, so I'm hoping within a week or two.
Okay. So you're talking, well, May to July, maybe?
Yeah, you know, if everything goes right, we'll be just about out of there by the time school really gets over for the summer.
Oh, okay.
You know, so.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be nice to get done before summertime and people are out really using their yards.
That's it, you know, it's a nice, it's just a small pile, so it shouldn't take us too long to move it. So.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Yep, sounds good.
All right. Other questions or comments, board? Mm-hmm. Staff, any additional items that the board should be aware of? Mr. Boyce, any additional thoughts, ideas from your end?
No, just here to answer questions.
All right. Good, thank you. Then, Mark, you'll get, you'll, complete the
process and get the payment from Mr. Boyce on that.
All right, and we'll get that underway, and then we'll reach out to the neighbor or neighbors to make sure that this is an FYI that we've got that going on.
Yep.
Okay, and in the approximate timeline, you know, from, it sounds like roughly May 1, you know, through maybe early July type of thing.
Yep.
Okay. Great, thank you.
All right, thanks
for the time.
Can you go to his birthday dinner now?
Yeah. His birthday dinner today?
Yeah. Yeah. The family came here to take him out.
Happy birthday.
I have a few more questions for you.
I'm sure he wanted me to share that on television.
All right, the next item under Public Works is a partial sidewalk waiver request for Bayview Landing Project. And so we'll tee it up for 2 and 3, site work along Wilbur Tract Road, Bayview Landing. Both of those kind of go hand in glove. So why don't we hit both of those, Mark?
Yep, they're two together. So basically, it showed the overall plan for Bayview Landing. This board was involved earlier when we were looking at doing some apartment buildings down below. They've scaled back that project. They're looking at 33 units up above, townhouses on that slope.
It's all planning board.
It's all planning board, except for a small piece down below, and that's why that's the second item we're talking about, is some minor improvements to the roadway coming in. So first item on the agenda is the sidewalk waiver. Mr. Howard is showing a sidewalk coming in off of Empire Boulevard all the way up Wilbur Tract Road up into his development and then going around the cul-de-sac. So he's showing basically a one-sided sidewalk, but he's got a lot of sidewalk, you know, just getting into the project before he's even into his portion there. So we discussed it with the PRC. PRC was supportive of that. Lake seen it come all the way out to Empire Boulevard. And then as we're looking at doing sidewalk improvements on Empire, we've had some CDBG grants to do sidewalks down Empire Boulevard, afford an opportunity for those residents to get out to Empire and then hopefully get some, you know, safe spots for them to cross out there. So that's the first item is, obviously, he has minimal frontage actually on Empire Boulevard. So there's really no frontage for him to put sidewalks on. But as whether this board is supportive of a one-sided sidewalk going up the hill and then looping in around the cul-de-sac on that piece.
Mm-hmm. So Mark, just a couple quick questions. From the cul-de-sac up into the neighborhood, the Woodhaven Drive neighborhood, what's happening? What does that look like? Again, recognize this is not coming before the town board, but that certainly was an item of interest, I think, both by this board and the fire district.
Correct.
So right. Where's Amelia? Where's Woodhaven?
Woodhaven is right here, just off the edge of this plan. They're proposing a dedicated road to come in here up to the cul-de-sac and back out. So this would be a new publicly dedicated road. Would need to be rebuilt to town standards. Off the end of this would be a private drive. This is the end of Bayview Landing's property, and then this is the existing portion that goes through Mr. Melio's property and up to Woodhaven. they've talked to these neighbors and we need to get, you know, work with them to do some improvements to that, whether that is, you know, some reinforced matting on the bottom, try to make it look you know, more residential. You can put some like concrete pavers down and have grass planted in it. We're working with the fire department to make sure that they're happy with that. It's H20 loading. It can accommodate a fire truck, can be plowed in the wintertime. And then they're having an association with this. So this will be a management company. They would be responsible to plow that, maintain that, keep that open in the wintertime.
And it will be gated when it's not being utilized for emergency access.
Yes, it will have a chain on both ends. It'll have a chain here, and I assume it'll have a chain at the top end. We'll have padlocks that are, you know, able to, universal keys for the fire department. They can get in and out, up and down. We shared that with the neighbors at the public hearing. The neighbors, you know, I can't say that every neighbor loved it, but I think they understand the need for it. They understand that we're not looking to open that access. We're not looking to open it through there. It is for emergency egress only, mainly to get their neighborhood out. Should a tree fall or
something. The tree did fall a few months before that, and yeah. I think that made
thankfully
them understand.
Thankfully, it was right by the daycare, right on the bend, right. So the cars actually were going around the daycare corner. Otherwise, the street would have been blocked off for several hours because the tree had fallen on a power line.
I did watch the board session. There was a good discussion between.
So I think that was well communicated.
Yeah.
I think the applicant did a nice job you know, expressing that and sharing that, and I think the neighbors understand that we're not looking to open that up.
Right.
The state DOT does not have jurisdiction over that. I think there was concerns that, you know, if something happened on Empire Boulevard, the state would take control and say we're routing people through that.
No.
They have no road or right of way through there. The easement is to the town of Penfield for this piece. It's not built to accommodate rerouting the traffic.
Right.
It is merely there as an emergency only access. Mm-hmm. You know, it's deemed possible. Deemed necessary to take the chains down, people can exit out. Or
so the cul-de-sac, though, the cul-de-sac, how do you get through the cul-de-sac to the road?
It's going to have a gutter around it, and it would just be a gutter you would drive through to go
no
back
than,
out.
No so different than a driveway.
Yeah, right. It's not a true cul-de-sac that's closed off.
No. It has a gutter around the outside of it, and then if people would access their driveway here, you'd have a little dip as you pull into your own driveway.
Right.
And then, you know, they would access it. So this would be a private drive portion.
Mm-hmm.
This piece would be dedicated, and then they would do some improvements to Wilbur Tract Road to their property line here as well, and then formalize an easement. Currently, it's by through use that the rest of the neighbors on Wilbur Tract Road access out to Empire Boulevard. We have not found any formal easement, but I mean, they've done it since the 1800s. We would formalize that easement and their right of access through, you know, out to Empire Boulevard.
How about the people up there on top of it? Can they walk down there too?
That's an issue because the property, the former PCOR site,
right.
Where that you can point to it. The easement that we have for that, we've gone through it many times, it's only for emergency access purposes. It's not for pedestrian use or anything.
Because they do go down it, right?
They do, and I don't think
I don't think
this project would be concerned by it.
How it would preclude that, as long as people are respectful and responsible, as well as the neighbors up above, there's not going to be a formal sidewalk. We're not, you know, trying to encourage that.
You're not trying to encourage it, but you're not going
to. It would really be to the discretion of the property owners that own the PCOR property now.
Uh-huh.
Because if they decided they didn't want public access through there, they could stop it.
Mm-hmm.
They have not done that in the past, as you noted. So
I mean, as well as, you know, Dr. Howitt and his group, you know, could put up signs. I don't think they're looking to do that. I think they're looking to be good neighbors. You know,
I was thinking about across the street, you know, over South Point, how the trails there, whatever, the road you're supposed to be, anybody can go there because it gives you access and along the waterfront, so to speak. And this one, well, this is access right down to the road, which you see the bay. And
At some point, we could probably talk to the property owners to see if they'd be willing to grant a public access easement through that area once it's more approved.
Mm-hmm.
They may be more inclined to do that. In the past, I think we have not approached them about that.
I think once they see how this plays out, this goes ahead, hopefully, you know, it goes ahead successfully, then, you know, maybe you could have more conversation about formalizing a sidewalk easement or a more formal trail easement or something between the two. They're also still looking at donating the part up above. He's still in conversations that would go to the county. They're looking to, you know, incorporate that in Lucian Warren Park. We've had conversations with the county. They're interested in taking it.
Sure.
You know, after some due diligence, do a phase one and make what's there. He has no intention of developing the upper portion, so he would rather donate that to the county. And there's many trails on it now. We walked it and we walked it with open space.
Yeah.
There's trails up and around, and you know, it's got some beautiful views on the top. So I think that'd be a great addition to the
park. So the road will in fact be dedicated.
The portion to here, yes, they're proposing to dedicate it. The planning board has not gone down that road yet. It's still in, you know, still in.
And the portion is from what we'll call the old Wilbur Track Road up, or all the way from Empire Boulevard?
All the way from Empire Boulevard.
Okay.
They're planning on redeveloping, rebuilding that whole road up through there, and that brings me to the second part of the discussion, if the board is.
So one last comment. There appears to be some type of a pull off or right there. So what is the intent?
I think they just had a loop around. So if you're plowing or you needed to loop, it's in there. You know, we could clean that out. I think that was just something they had shown, just as a turnaround. If people got down the road, realized, you know, either they weren't in the right spot or something, they could loop around and head back out.
I think the other part of it was they were trying to identify the remaining portion of Wilbur Track to the where the residents are, to try and create some type of a separation, so that was understood to be a private drive from that point on.
So as they came in, Wilbur Track Road continuing down there, mm-hmm. back where the Schneffs
and this year, but if you came in and, you know, rather than trying to figure out turnaround, I think they gave them a little turnaround here that, you know, if you got down the road. This is still pending before the planning board. They've not rendered any decision at this point. We wanted to want to make sure, you know, where the town board was on the sidewalk piece. And then, you know, the second piece, this does come through the LaSalle's Landing District. This board has jurisdiction over that area. There's no proposed building structures in that area, but obviously they're doing some improvements to the roadway and installing the sidewalk. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's the second item on your agenda, is to show, I have a blow up of that piece.
Mark, while you're getting there, the other issue regarding that separation is that there's going to be a different name for that new road going up. They will not be on Wilbur Track, most probably. The Wilbur Track will remain where the Schneffs and the rest of them are now. But that will be a different street name, and that's what the separation was about.
I think if they're willing to build it.
So this is the lower piece. This is just a blow up of that other map. Shows all that jazz. Empire Boulevard here. LaSalle's Landing. Boundary line is here. This is the area that they would be doing some improvements in the LaSalle's Landing District. Mm-hmm. So wanted to bring that before this board as well, showing the planning on rebuilding the road, adding gutters, doing some storm
Is there any effect on the wetlands?
No. The wetlands are off this map over here. They'd also be adding sidewalks in it as well, but there's no proposed, what I would call, development of homes. And
do town plows plow that portion of Empire Boulevard right now?
Yes.
Empire Boulevard, yes.
Of the Empire Boulevard, but not...
No, not that part. So, what do they usually turn around? At the town line, like a Bayfront restaurant, or...?
No, I think they actually go up the hill.
I think they go to the top of the hill and run a quick turnaround up there.
So, we have that portion. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, that's just an improvement. There's nothing...
No, there's no proposed development, but it is in LaSalle's Landing District that falls under this board's jurisdiction.
No, what I think we do is bring it in for,
bring it to the board, make sure to memorialize it,
so that it's
make it a true road, not a core road that was just made.
And the road is built to town standards?
It is not today.
Well, I know, I understand. So the proposal, I apologize. The proposal is to build it to town specs, including the cul-de-sac?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep, and they would add drainage and... So I think
gutters, and
it would be a betterment CVs to the residents that currently live on Wilbur Track Road, betterment to all that jazz. So there's other businesses that access off of that. It creates a better environment for them, and it creates a.
Do they have any lighting access going up the road?
They are showing a couple of lights. I think they have a light here on the side. We've also talked to them about putting a pole-mounted light at the entrance,
consistent with our,
which is consistent with what we do with other subdivisions. So I think that would be a betterment to the existing residents on Wilbur Track Road that have not had the road is not in great shape today. There is no light at the bottom, so I think, you know, it would be an improvement for them.
Well, I'm thinking about the streetscape style lighting going up the hill there by the sidewalk. I mean, are the residents going to have, is that going to be the homeowners? If there are lighting, otherwise, is it going to be in the town's dedicated easement?
I think they just had the one at the entrance, and I think they have some on their property up in here, some yard lights and other things that would be under the association, for the...
Yeah, they're not doing an intensified
management company.
Okay.
Is there any concern about the cul-de-sac for the plows and something like that?
It would be designed to our town standard, so that's...
They don't love those, though, typical. Snow plows.
Well, I mean, certainly some of the older subdivisions that have the smaller cul-de-sacs and have the grass in the center, tend to be more of a problem than some of the larger ones that we've recently, you know, given them the radius in order to make the turns with the trucks and the equipment and things.
So this will have to have that.
That's why I'd asked if it was consistent with the town's design criteria, because if it is, then it, it makes it consistent for.
We were constrained, we did look at alternatives. Obviously, the one alternative was to go straight through, which was not an alternative. We talked to the neighbors, we know what their concern is, and we're going to adhere to what they want. The other one was to look at a loop system, but the property's not wide enough to accommodate a loop system and get any type of development out of it, so we really were stuck with the cul-de-sac.
Yeah, here's the wetland areas you get to down below, the proposed stormwater management area. So once you get off the side, there's a lot of wetlands. Once you get off the other side, there's a lot of steep slopes in here that come down from the property up above.
Okay, board, two items. One is the sidewalk piece on one side versus two, and then the road being within the LaSalle's Landing District, consistent with what our requirements are to memorialize that aspect of it. Questions, concerns?
It's fine.
Yep.
Staff, any additional thoughts or concerns that we should discuss or talk about that we have not discussed on this project?
Actually, this project has gone very well, and I'm very pleased that the neighbors and Dr. Howe were able to work out details to get to where we all are at this point in time.
Good. Okay, good. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Kaz. This will take us down into informational items, and our first informational item under Law and Finance is the Joey's Pasta House Edition application that the town has received.
Thanks, Tony. Yes, we've received our application. All the materials are in. I will be, with your permission, putting in a resolution setting a public hearing for May 18th. We'll be getting all the materials out to you so you can review it in advance, and get him squared away.
Great.
And so we're looking for a public hearing?
Yes.
For that?
For May 18th.
May 18th.
Yep.
Okay, so May 18th. All right, any other questions or comments for that? All right, this brings us to our second information item, signed ordinance update. This is Jim Costello and myself, and I see that we have Dr. Sannon here with us this evening that is listening in. The discussion that has been had in and around the sign ordinance is with regards to signage on both sides of the building. We have a number of different applications, developments, buildings, businesses, and things like that that have frontage, if you will, on a couple of different roads or a couple of different sides. So in the case of Dr. Sannon, his building faces on 441, but if you take a look, he has access to the back of that building. And so one of the items that had come up is that the ordinance currently does not allow for that. Dr. Sannon has come into the Zoning Board of Appeals on two different occasions for some additional signage, and that was denied. We do have some situations across the town, dependent upon the district that you're in, and then who supports that, whether it's the Zoning Board of Appeals or it's a town board application, again, dependent upon the district. And so we've got some inconsistencies that have taken place, where we have some businesses that have multiple signs, the signs on the front and the signs on the back, again, dependent upon where they're facing. And then we've had a number of applications in the past that have come in and have been denied. So we're lacking in a little bit of consistency. So Jim has done quite a bit of work of going out, you know, taking a look at that signage, documenting that, and what have you. And the proposal that we're bringing to the board is for us to make an adjustment to the sign ordinance, again, from a consistency standpoint.
Exactly.
Looking at making sure that one entity is an advantage, where another one might be disadvantaged.
Are you referring to townwide or just within the Four Corners?
No, we'd be looking at across the entire town. So the adjustment would not be to a specific district.
Would it be signs that face a road? I mean, like if you're...
It would either be a road, or if you were interior to a, into a plaza, for instance, that you have that, that ability. So we have an example just up from where Dr. Sannon is today, is that you have the subway, and the subway has three signs. Again, if you're coming 250, or if you're coming 441, or if you're coming from within the plaza. And we have a number of other...
So how did they get that? Now, the zoning board would have had that.
Well, that's right. That gets back to that.
But they allowed subway, but they wouldn't allow him, so... Is it different,
That's where we get into the consistency. That's where we get into the consistency piece.
Right, so the existing zoning board could have made an exception and granted it based on that, but they followed the strict reading of the ordinance, and you're saying that...
They have in some cases, and they haven't in other cases.
If we change the ordinance to allow it, then they won't have that problem.
Well, then certainly the only time that they would then have to come into the zoning board is if the signs were, you know, too big or more than allowed by code and what have you.
Okay.
So I know Jim and I have wrestled with this because of this whole issue around signs and cleaning up signs and not being, you know, having too much signage and things like that.
Yeah, I'm definitely all for consistency. I've sort of, you know, we've had many sign discussions in the four corners, and my argument has always been about the consistency there. I guess, Jim, from your perspective, or Tony, from yours, I mean, what do you see as far as just additional sign pollution, I guess, if you will, as a...
Well, I think Tony hit it on that, particularly as it relates to Dr. Sannon and others, to have, if you have internal structures within a plaza setting, where you can find them from the parking lot, so that good examples, coming in from one side on 250, and not coming in from Penfield Road. If you're coming in the back side, you should be able to see Dr. Sannon's office or whoever is back there, so that you know where to go. Because if you're not doing that, you're probably creating some kind of traffic problem because you're trying to find that place and you're not getting there.
Right.
The same is true with what you did in the four corners, which was probably right on target, you know, with Mott's Lane coming in. You did allow signs in the back also in the four corners area where, you know, you've got all those buildings in the back there, you identified signage in the back to allow people to understand where
and
they
the,
have to
there
be.
Are properties, I think, this is, what has been consistent is that the exceptions seem to be properties that, at least from our perspective, have the inability to have a freestanding sign,
right,
or it's not practical to have a freestanding sign, or it's duplicative to have a freestanding sign, but that there's this additional signage on another part of the building would, from a safety perspective and directional perspective, be appropriate.
Correct.
So it seems to be just conforming that townwide to what our strategy, our philosophy has been, at least on this board, I think, when we've looked in the four corners.
So how does this address any kind of legacy signs or grandfathered signs where if there already are two at certain locations where that's permissible by code but not three, and now they're looking at increasing, are we going to have to look at each case individually?
You would
say,
absolutely have to, yes.
Okay, so are we going to see a long list of these at some point? I mean, is that your... I guess I'm just trying to get a sense of...
No, it's a good question, though, because I think after the March sign, I did get a couple people calling, but then it's kind of faded away a little bit. I think, you know, when you really have a situation where you have multiple points of entry, particularly into a plaza, and most people are coming in from 250, they're coming from the north, and they're not seeing Dr. Sannon's office or other users, and that's why Subway got what Subway got years and years ago.
Yeah.
I think you have to accommodate the public to accommodate to let them know where proper direction to these buildings are.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, I'm not.
I don't think we want to rewrite the ordinance by any means.
No, and I don't want to have small businesses having to keep coming in for exceptions and not being able to make a judgment call as to whether the likelihood of success on their application, whether it's worth going forward or not, and going through the expense of, you know, drawing up a sign. And
that's
so I think there's a lot of small businesses who wouldn't even want to do that because it's an expense. So.
And to follow up on your thought, and you're right, I mean, it's like any other thing. So if you have somebody coming in for a lot of variances on the same issue, we probably should be looking at why they're doing that. And if that's a problem that needs to be resolved, we have to do it. So you're right. We need to look at this and see how it addresses all the other issues. And you've got the plazas, and the plazas are all redeveloping now anyways. So we do need to get them better visibilities or color.
And if we are going to promote the plaza plausibility,
Plausibility.
Walkability within a plaza, maybe?
That it's only fair that we take a look at signage with respect to those kind of landlocked businesses.
I think you're going to see some more on Penfield Road as well, right across from Wegmans. This board rezoned those to B&R, and we're proposing, and we're moving ahead with that rear access drive. We got urgent care, eyesight, some of those. We've taken away their curb cut along Penfield Road, so they want a sign on Penfield Road with the visibility, but their access is actually going to be from the rear. You're not even going to be able to get to it from Penfield Road, so you need to get some wayfinding signs, and then once you're on that rear access drive, know which business you have. So you're, you know, they're going to be looking for a front sign on Penfield Road for visibility, and then a rear access is
your public safety.
It is, and the area of it is, we already provide for that in our ordinance, and you've seen that over where McDonald's is and the bank and everything else. So this is one of the last pieces to really look at and get a feel for how we can resolve it. And you look at Baytown, what's happening at Baytown now.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to have a lot of interior buildings that are going to need to have some visibility, so. So we'll start working on some recommendations for you and hopefully come back fairly quickly for you. This should not be a long drive.
I was just going to say, I would look to just have it turned around for our next work session.
It could easily be done.
Then do a heavy hearing.
And then go through it. So, okay, so our action item to come back is come back with those recommendations finalized for the 27th.
Sounds good.
Okay. Other questions by the board? Dr. Sandin, I know you came. Any comments that you would like to make?
No, I mean, number one,
if you just join us at the, and I only say that because we capture.
Absolutely. No, thanks, actually, for bringing us to the table. You and I have had a number of conversations about this in the last two and a half years, whatever. You know, my application was denied twice by the Zoning Board of Appeals. Why, I still don't know. And what bothers me is consistency, you know. If they denied me because the ordinance says that, that's great, that's fine. But the month prior to my application, when I first put it in, Tim Hortons was approved, you know, and they didn't even balk at it. They're 400 yards down the road from me. Just recently, I think urgent care was given approval. So there's no rhyme or reason as to why one business or establishment is approved and why another isn't. So
I think the key is that the consistency
exactly.
really is
right.
is you got to be able to
all across the board just one sign, or let's do ordinance and allow, especially with multiple accesses of entry. If something's landlocked, Tim Hortons doesn't even have multiple accesses, but it's got two signs. So the rhyme and the reasoning doesn't really make sense. Mm-hmm. We need to figure that out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So, thank you.
Well, they do have. I mean, if you think about it, one could argue they do have two access points because you can get from your, I mean, it's kind of a circuitous route
exactly.
to do that, but you know, from
exactly.
where your property,
but again, you know, they're a national chain with name recognition, like Subway. People know the colors. People could smell the coffee, probably. I'm not like that.
No.
You know, so again, you know, for me, the problem is I have a building right next to me, La Bella Spa, with no sign. My patients inadvertently end up going there, and we get their patients as well. So, you know, that's why we need the sign.
Yeah.
It's not to create more sign pollution. It's not to create I'm trying to help customers, help the residents.
Right.
So, and my business.
Okay. Makes sense here.
Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good to see you. All right, board, that brings us to the end of the informal. There are no other items to come before the board.
No.
We'll adjourn the meeting at 8:01 p.m. We have just one item to finish up on for an executive session for a legal matter, and then we'll get everyone home to their families.